Srinidhi said, "My dear boy, whatever has been spoken by Srinidhi is so, because the king, your father, does not consider me his wife or even his maidservant. He feels ashamed to accept. Therefore, it is a fact that you've taken birth from the womb of an unfortunate woman, and by being fed from her breast, you've grown up. My dear boy, whatever has been spoken by Srinidhi, your stepmother, although very harsh to hear, is factual. Therefore, if you desire at all to sit on the same throne as your stepbrother Uttama, then give up your envious attitude and immediately try to execute the instructions of your stepbrother. Without further delay, you must engage yourself in worshipping the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of God." So Niji continued, "The Supreme Personality of God is so great that simply by worshipping his lotus feet, your great-grandfather, Lord Brahma, acquired the necessary qualifications to create this universe. Although he is unborn, he is the chief of all living creatures. He is situated in an exalted post because of the mercy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, whom even great yogis worship by controlling the mind and regulating the life there, Brahma." Suniti informed her son, "Your grandfather, Swayambhu Brahmana, executed great sacrifices with distribution of charity, and thereby, with unflinching faith and devotion, he worshipped and satisfied the Supreme Personality of Godhead. By acting in that way, he achieved the greatest success in material happiness, and afterwards achieved liberation, which is impossible to obtain by worshipping the devil. My dear boy, you also should take shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is very kind to his devotees. Persons seeking liberation from the cycle of birth and death always take shelter of the lotus feet of the Lord in devotion to service, becoming purified by executing your allotted occupation. Just situate the Supreme Personality in your heart, and without deviating for a moment, always engage in his service. My dear Dhruva, as far as I am concerned, I do not find anyone who can mitigate your distress but the Supreme Personality of Godhead, whose eyes are like lotus petals. Many demigods, such as Lord Brahma, seek the pleasure of the Goddess of Fortune, but the Goddess of Fortune herself, with the lotus flower in her hand, is always ready to render service to the Supreme Lord." The great sage Maitreya continues, "The instruction of Dhruva Maharaj's mother, Suniti, was actually meant for fulfilling his desired objective. Therefore, after deliberate consideration, and with intelligence and fixed determination, he left his father's house."
Even how an envious person now was giving good instruction.
He said, one can take good instruction from a fool. So in this way, we have received the instructions that only the Supreme Personality of Godhead would be the one to give him shock. And then Dhruva inquired from his mother where the Supreme Personality of Godhead could be found. And she said that he could be found in the forest. Many were looking for the Lord in the forest. He could be found there. So that was the beginning of Dhruva Maharaj's endeavors to approach the Supreme Personality of God. And that made Dhruva Maharaj a great and powerful sadhaka. Bhagavatam has dedicated 5 chapters to Dhruva Maharaj, his pastimes. And of course, it's a little bit much to meet all at once here. So what I'm planning to do is to read a little bit from every chapter and then comment a little bit. It may take a little time, but I think it's worth it. Because we want to go a little deeper than just quickly approach the last time on the surface. I could tell you, of course, the Dhruva story, which everybody knows anyway. Just to sort of say, we are here now in Dhruva Jiva, and this is the place where Dhruva wound up in the forest. Quite a place, because it happened to be in Braj. That makes quite a difference, not just for us, but actually in the Holy Dhamma. So that is one first point to note. The other point is, let us look at Dhruva's character. Dhruva has a kshatriya nature, and there are some typical characteristics in him. One is that he has incredible determination. Kshatriyas can really fix their mind in a very strong way. So Dhruva is extremely fixed, extremely. And that determination, when engaged in devotional service, becomes a valuable quality. Nothing is going to stop him. That is something to note. Another thing to note is Dhruva gets very angry, not just a little angry, but deeply angry. I mean, not just hot. Oh yes, he gets hot, but he gets like angry to the core of his being, deeply angry. That is much more dangerous than the type of anger that flares up and then after you think, well, what did I do? It's when someone becomes deeply angry, that his whole being is just overwhelmed by that anger. In this way, Dhruva's anger did not just come down. It wasn't that just he was angry and then it disappeared. You see that Dhruva went into the forest, and the Narada Muni, who is an amazing personality, in the purports of these chapters, it is described that Narada Muni, how did Narada Muni know that Dhruva was in that particular state of consciousness? How did Narada know that Dhruva was not only angry, but that he had that very special determination? How did Narada know? It says, Narada knows the consciousness of all living beings. That's what it says in the book. You better watch out. Leave your thoughts. But imagine just the potency of Narada Muni. He knows the consciousness of all living beings. How is it possible that any human being can be so powerful. Any living entity can become so powerful. But that is what is described in the photos. It's astounding. So in this way, Narada knew straight away, used the word. And he now has come to a level of determination which is just extraordinary. It is very, very rarely found in anyone such a level of determination. All right, let me somehow or other steer that. He has determination, he wants the Supreme Lord, but for the wrong motive. For the wrong motive. So, Narada came, and Narada instructed Dhruva what to do. First, Narada questioned Dhruva, and Narada said that, okay, Dhruva, you can go home now. You can go home. I mean, it's okay, you know, it was bad. I mean, you have a good reason to be upset and angry, but, you know, you're in the forest now, it's not really a place to be, you know. You can go home. Dhruva didn't want to hear that. He wasn't hearing it. It's just basically, you know, I cannot hear these things. He even said it. I cannot hear this. Mine is fixed. I'll stay here and I will not go. Very determined. So, in this way, Dhruva remained in that fortress. Then Narada, after testing him like that, could see that Dhruva actually was a good candidate. So then he told him what to do. Okay, he instructed him in Astanga Yoga. We're now in a different yoga. He told him how to practice controlling the mind, controlling the senses, and all these things that he did. But that was not all. He also told him to engage in deity worship. And this told him to make a deity out of clay. Just make a form out of clay yourself. And you worship that form as the Supreme Personality of God. And then, most important of all, more important than Astanga, more important than deity, most important of all, and gave him the instruction to change. He gave the instruction to chant Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. 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 So in this way, Dhruva began his sadhana. And we know that he performed great austerity, that he was, he started to fast and this and that, you know. That's described in detail of how Dhruva started to eat only leaves from that he found on the ground. And then, at one point he stopped that also, and then only some water, and then only some water every once in a while, and finally it came to the point where he was only breathing sometimes, not too often, big gaps in his breathing. And at that stage, Dhruva's austerity began to affect the entire universe, and when he was not breathing, then the demigods could not breathe either. And everyone was suffocating. Intense. So, then the Supreme Lord appeared. And at that stage, the Supreme Lord appeared before Dhruva and was. Thank you. Anyway, Dhruva, in that forest, received the darshan of the Supreme Lord. Chapter 8 is basically how Dhruva left home and stayed in the forest, how he performed his fast, how the Lord appeared before him, and how the Lord gave him different benedictions. And then, in the next chapter, chapter 9, is called Dhruva Maharaj Returns Home. So now he returns home, and no longer the same person. So that's, it still goes on in the darshan with the Supreme Lord, and we begin with that. Although Dhruva Maharaj was a small boy, he wanted to offer prayers to the Supreme Personality of Godhead in suitable language. But because he was inexperienced, he could not adjust himself immediately. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, being situated in everyone's heart, could understand Dhruva Maharaj's awkward position. Out of his causeless mercy, he touched his conch shell to the forehead of Dhruva Maharaj, who stood before him with folded hands. At that time, Dhruva Maharaj became perfectly aware of the Vedic conclusion and understood the absolute truth in his relationship with all living entities. In accordance with the line of devotional service to the Supreme Lord, whose fame is widespread, Dhruva Maharaj, who in the future would receive a planet which would never be annihilated, even during the time of dissolution, offered his deliberate and conclusive prayers. The Personality of Godhead said, "My dear Dhruva, son of the king, you have executed pious vows, and I also know the desire within your heart. Although your desire is very ambitious and very difficult to fulfill, I shall favor you with its fulfillment. All good fortune unto you." The Supreme Personality of Godhead continued, "My dear Dhruva, I shall award you a glowing planet known as the Pole Star, which will continue to exist even after the dissolution at the end of the millennium. No one has ever ruled this planet, which is surrounded by all the solar systems, planets and stars. All the luminaries in the sky circumambulate this planet, just as bulls thread around the central pole for the purpose of crushing grains. Keeping the pole star to their right, all the stars inhabited by the great sages like Dharma, Atmikasyapa and Sukra circumambulate this planet, which continues to exist even after the dissolution of planets." Now, so Dhruva wanted a planet, he wanted a kingdom greater than his father, greater than his grandfather, greater than all his ancestors. So that meant greater than Lord Rama, so that's what he thought. But that's not all that Dhruva got, and this is something to note, that when Dhruva was very angry, as I said before, it was a very deep anger. It was an anger that did not cool down at all. It just continued to burn, deeply burn within him. And as a result, when he was thinking of Suruchi, he wished that she would burn. And so, after Dhruva had performed all his austerities, after Dhruva had completed these austerities, then, and his desires were fulfilled, then at one point the Supreme Lord says, "Yes, I know your desires, I know the desires of your heart in the kingdom," and then he says, "Yes, and Suruchi, you see, will go on some excursion into a forest fire and she will burn. She will burn up into a forest fire." So be careful what you desire. Right. And Uttam, because Dhruva has also been thinking about Uttam, you know. If I can't sit on the lap of my father, then Uttam can't sit on the lap of my father. And if Uttam is the favorite son of my father, then I wish him dead. And then what happened? Uttam would also be killed by the Yakshas. So all this is like also there. Sometimes forgotten. You know, this is like a forgotten part of the story. But But it's an intense part of the story. But anyway, it is also whatever may be. We look upon death as something very, very grave, because from our current perspective, we can see only this life, and then death means like, oh my God. But the Supreme Personality of Godhead looks upon death a little different. Just changing dress. I hope everyone changed dress from yesterday. Anyway, that's okay. So it's just a change of dress according to Bhagavad Gita. So in that way, and Krishna is, so Krishna was not necessarily favoring Dhruva. And in the course of benedicting Dhruva, casting Suruchi and Uttam into hell. Not like that. But still, there was a reaction. So, then Dhruva returned home from the forest, and as he came home, the news was brought to King Uttanabhad. He was in the forest. So Uttanabhad immediately, he felt very guilty. He was not just coming out of love for his son, but as he had affection for his son, but it was mixed with guilt also, because he had neglected him. So therefore, he really came all out, and it was like a big, everyone went out of the palace, and a big, big procession went up. And King Upakutanapad, being very eager to see the face of his lost son, mounted a chariot, drawn by excellent horses, and equipped with golden filigree, taking with him many learned Brahmins, all the elderly personalities of his family, his officers, his ministers, and his immediate friends. He immediately left the city. As he proceeded in this parade, there were auspicious sounds of conch shells, kettle drums, flutes, and the chanting of Vedic mantras to indicate all good fortune. Both the queens of King Uttanapad, namely Suniti and Surichi, along with his other son Uttama, appeared in the procession. The kings were seated on the ground. Upon seeing Dhruva Maharaj approaching the neighboring small forest, King Uttanapad, with great haste, got down from his chariot. He had been very anxious for a long time to see his son Dhruva, and therefore with great love and affection he went forward to embrace his long-lost boy, breathing very heavily. The king embraced him with both arms. But Dhruva Maharaj was not the same as before. He was completely sanctified by spiritual advancement due to having been touched by the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of God. Reunion with Dhruva Maharaj fulfilled King Uttanapad's long-cherished desire, and for this reason he smelled Dhruva's head again and again and bathed him with torrents of very cold tears. Thus Dhruva Maharaj, the foremost of all nobles, first of all offered his obeisances at the feet of his father and was honored by his father with various questions. He then bowed his head at the feet of his two mothers. Interesting. May be questioned in the purport. Why Dhruva Maharaj offered his respects not only to his mother but also to his stepmother due to his insults and had to leave home? The answer is that after achieving perfection by self-realization and seeing the Supreme Personality of Godhead face to face, Dhruva Maharaj was completely freed from all contamination of material desire. Feelings of insult or honor in this material world are never perceived by a devotee. Lord Chaitanya therefore says that one is to be humbler than the grass and recommends more tolerant than the tree to execute devotional service. Dhruva Maharaj, therefore, and in this verse been described as Sajjanagrani. Sajjanagrani, the foremost of noble men. The pure devotee is the noblest of all, and he has no feeling of animosity toward anyone. Duality due to animosity is a creation of this material world. Therefore, there is no such thing in the spiritual world which is the absolute reality. Suruchi, the younger mother of Dhruva Maharaj, seeing that the innocent boy had fallen at her feet, immediately picked him up, embracing him with her hands, and with tears of feeling she blessed him with the words, "My dear boy, long may you live. Unto one who has transcendental qualities due to friendly behavior with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, all living entities offer honor, just as water automatically flows down by nature." It's amazing, huh? Oh, Suruchi now also was, she was also having good feelings, but at the same time, he was so sacred, so amazing. The two brothers, Uttam and Dhruva Maharaj, also exchanged tears. They were overwhelmed by ecstasy of love and affection. When they embraced one another, the hair of their bodies stood up. Suniti, the real mother of Dhruva Maharaj, embraced the tender body of her son, who was dearer to her than her own life, and thus forgot all material grief, for she was very pleased. My dear Vidura, Suniti was the mother of a great hero. Her tears, together with the milk flowing from her breast, wet the whole body of Dhruva Maharaj. This was a great auspicious sign. So in the next chapter, Dhruva Maharaj fights with the Yakshas. So as I was saying, that Suruchi, she somehow or other left this world in a forest fire. And then, Dhruva Maharaj's heart, which was pierced by the arrows of the harsh words of his stepmother, was greatly aggrieved, and thus when he fixed upon his goal of life, he did not forget her misbehavior. He did not demand actual liberation from this material world, but at the end of his devotional service, when the Supreme Personality of Godhead appeared before him, he was simply ashamed of the material demands in his mind. Dhruva was now saying, "I trade for things which are perishable." Of course, we know he prayed for broken pieces of glass instead of diamonds. Just be tolerated. someone was killed of a particular royal house, then it was the duty of the king to retaliate, to protect the kingdom, so that anyone who don't mess with this kingdom, otherwise they might mess with the kingdom again. So therefore, it was his duty to go and retaliate. So Dhruva went, and he was ready to retaliate. And he had all kinds of weapons, astras, and so on. So Rakshas, of course, they are living in the northern part of India, in the Himalayas. And they are particularly employing mystic power. And they are engaging in some tantric rituals and invoking various illusory energies. So they were masters of illusions. And Dhruva was a master in fighting with various celestial weapons. So it became an enormous fight, And Dhruva invoked very, very powerful weapons. And then Dhruva just, again became overwhelmed by anger. And this time his anger was just, again, uncontrolled, burning like a enormous fire. And Dhruva was just killing yaksha after yaksha after yaksha. Just finally, Kuvera, who is the grandfather of the Yakshas, along with Swayambhuvamana, the elders appeared. And it is described how these two elders were completely aloof, and how they were meditating on the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and how they were not usually involved with worldly affairs. They didn't bother with these things. But for this occasion, they came down. They came down from their normal platform of being aloof, because Dhruva was in the process of killing the entire Yaksha race. And that was not according to the plan and arrangement of the Supreme Lord. Therefore, it was time now to stop it. It was going beyond a response to the aggression of the Yakshas. As a Kshatriya had a duty to fight and to show them. But he was just going on and on and on. So then Swayambhuvamana and Kuvera came and calmed him down and told him to stop.
Shooting his own guilt feelings.
today, we can see that there are very deep issues, underlying issues in the matter. Anyway, like that, Dhruva fought with the Yakshas, and Swayambhuva Mangala advised Dhruva Maharaj to stop fighting. And then we get, finally, chapter 12, the last chapter. And there it is described how Dhruva is going back to Gaur. So there's first a little bit more about the Yakshas. So Kuvira is speaking. O sinless son of Kshatriya, I'm very glad to know that under the instruction of your grandfather, you've given up your enmity. Although it's very difficult to avoid, I'm very pleased with you. Actually, you've not killed the Yakshas, nor have they killed your brother. But the ultimate cause of generation and annihilation is the eternal time feature of the Supreme Lord. Misidentification of oneself and others as I and you on the basis of the bodily concept of life is a product of ignorance. This bodily concept is the cause of repeated birth and death, and it makes us go on continuously in material existence. My dear Dhruva, come forward. May the Lord always grace you with good fortune. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is beyond sense, our sensory perception, is the Super Soul of all living entities. And thus, all entities are one without distinction, being therefore to render service unto the chosen form, that is the never form of the Lord, who is the ultimate shelter of all living entities. So all this partiality and all this spirit of killing the Yakshas, seeing them as enemies, all that. Kuvira was now looking at the transcendental perspective. Go a little further in the chapter. So Dhruva Maharaj ruled over this planet for 36,000 years to diminish the reactions of pious activities by enjoyment and by practicing austerities. He diminished inauspicious reactions. The self-controlled great soul Dhruva Maharaj thus passed many, many favorable years executing three kinds of worldly activities, namely religiosity, economic development, and satisfaction of all material desires. Thereafter, he handed over the charge of the royal throne to his son. Srila Dhruva Maharaj realized that this cosmic manifestation bewilders living entity like a dream of phantasmagoria, because it's a creation of the illusory external energy of the Supreme Lord. Thus Dhruva Maharaj at the end left his kingdom, which extended all over the earth and was bounded by the great oceans, to consider his body, his wives, his children, his friends, his army, his rich treasury, his comfortable palaces, and his many enjoyable pleasure grounds to be the creations of the illusory energy. Thus in the course of time, he retired to the forest in the Himalayas known as Badrikashram. In Badrikashram, Dhruva Maharaj's senses became completely purified because he bathed regularly in the crystal clear purified water. He fixed his sitting position and by yogic practice controlled the breathing process and the air of life. In this way, his senses were completely withdrawn. Then he concentrated his mind on the Archa-Vikrama form of the Lord, which is the exact replica of the Lord, and thus meditating upon him, entered him to complete trance. Because of his transcendental bliss, incessant tears flowed from his eyes. His heart melted, and there was shivering and standing of the hairs all over his body. Thus transformed, in a trance of devotional service, Dhruva Maharaj completely forgot his bodily existence, and thus he immediately became liberated from material bondage. As soon as the symptoms of his liberation were manifest, he saw a beautiful airplane coming down from the sky, as if the brilliant moon were coming down, illuminating all generations. Dhruva Maharaj saw two very beautiful associates of the Lord, of Lord Vishnu in the plain. They had four hands and a blackish body, luster. They were very youthful, and their eyes were just like Reddy's lotus flower. They held clubs in their hands, and they were dressed in very attractive garments with helmets, and were decorated with necklaces, bracelets, and earrings. Dhruva Maharaj seeing that these uncommon personalities were direct servants of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, immediately stood up, but being puzzled, in hastiness he forgot how to receive them in the proper way. Therefore he simply offered his obeisances with folded hands and chanted and glorified the holy name of God. What's more proper than that? All external etiquette, not required. He stood, maybe he should have bowed down, but he stood with folded hands, but he chanted the holy name. Dhruva Maharaj was always absorbed in thinking of the lotus feet of Lord Krishna. His heart was full with Krishna. When the two confidential servants of the Supreme Lord, who were named Nanda and Sunanda, approached him, smiling happily, Dhruva stood with folded hands, bowing humbly. They then addressed him as follows. Nanda and Sunanda, the two confidential associates of Lord Vishnu, said, "Dear King, let there be all good fortune unto you. Please attentively hear what we shall say. When you were only 5 years old, you underwent severe austerities and you thereby prayed to satisfy the Supreme Personality of Godhead. We are representatives of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the creator of the whole universe, who carries in his hand the pole named Savinda, who has been specifically deputed to take you to the spiritual world. To achieve Vishnuloka is very difficult, but by your austerity you have conquered. Even the great rishis and demigods cannot achieve this position. Simply to see the supreme abode, Vishnu planet, the sun and the moon, and all other planets, stars, lunar mansions, and solar mansions are circumambient. Now please come. You're welcome to go there. Dear Dhruva, neither your forefathers nor anyone else before you ever achieved such a transcendental planet. The planet known as Vishnuloka, where Lord Vishnu personally resides, is the highest of all. It is worshipable by the inhabitants of all other planets within the universe. Please come with us and live there eternally. O immortal one, the unique airplane has been sent by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is worshipped by selected prayers, and who is the chief of all living entities. You are quite worthy to board such a plane." Before getting aboard, Dhruva Maharaj worshipped the airplane, circumambulated, and also offered obeisances to the associates of Vishnu. In the meantime, he became as brilliant, as illuminating, as molten gold. He was thus completely prepared to board the transcendental plane. When Dhruva Maharaj was attempting to get on the transcendental plane, he saw death personified approach him. Not caring for death, however, he took advantage of the opportunity to put his feet on the head of death, and thus he got off on the airplane, which was as big as a house. At that time, drums and kettle drums resounded from the sky. The chief Gandharvas began to sing, and other demigods showered flowers like torrents of rain upon Dhruva Maharaj. Dhruva was seated in the transcendental airplane, which was just about to start, when he remembered his poor mother Suni. He thought to himself, "How shall I go alone to the Vaikuntha planet and leave behind my poor mother?" The great associates of Vaikuntha Loka, Nanda and Sunanda, could understand the mind of Dhruva Maharaj, and thus they showed him that his mother Suniti was going forward in another plane. And then hear this purport. The incident proves that the Siksha or Diksha Guru has a disciple who strongly executes devotional service like Dhruva Maharaj can be carried by the disciple, even though the instructor is not as advanced. Although Suniti was an instructor to Dhruva Maharaj, she could not go to the forest because she was a woman, nor could she execute austerities and penances as Dhruva Maharaj did. Still, Dhruva Maharaj was able to take his mother with him. Similarly, Prahlad Maharaj also delivered his atheistic father, Hiranya Kasipu. The conclusion is that a disciple or an offspring who is a very strong devotee can carry with him to Vaikuntha Loka either his father, mother, or Siksha or Diksha Guru. Srila Bhaktivedanta Saraswati used to say, "If I could perfectly deliver even one soul back home, back to Godhead, I would think my mission propagating Krishna consciousness to be successful. The Krishna conscious movement is spreading now all over the world, and sometimes I think that even though I am crippled in many ways, if one of my disciples becomes as strong as Dhruva Maharaj, then he will be able to carry me with him to to Vaikuntha Loka. So this is a Prabhupada's amazing purport. Prabhupada's moment of like just having that vision of utmost humility and just thinking, yes. As Dhruva carried his instructing Guru, his mother, in the same way, maybe one of my disciples will carry me back home. So that is amazing. So we're an amazing family, we're an amazing sampradaya. It is not all well, it is all happening according to the book, but the book is not like a dry book which is just giving some dry quotes and then everything is understood. We're seeing that so many relations can exist, and then even sometimes the disciple can take back the guru. I think the technical point has been made. Even that is possible. How can it be? Just by being faithful in the sampradaya, everything will happen. So that's the essence. The essence is don't bring the gold skill. Don't rate everybody. Are they pure enough? Are they this? Are they that? Just let us be faithful and take shelter, because we are being carried by the entire sampradaya. We're not just being carried by one person. We're not just carried by our spiritual master alone. Of course, our spiritual master, we are worshipping our spiritual masters. We are appreciating our spiritual masters as exalted. And we see them as such. But we should know the spiritual master is empowered within the sampradaya. He becomes a potent transcendental energy because he's living faithfully according to the injunctions of the previous acharyas. He just becomes empowered by them. He becomes empowered by Krishna, who accepts him because it's Krishna's system, and Krishna begins to work through him. Krishna accepts service to him. Krishna gives instructions to him, and in this way, the spiritual master is a via media. The spiritual master is the postman, as Prabhupada said, and that is how it works. Somehow or other, in a whole system, coming from Krishna and many great acharyas and so on. So in this way, Dhruva Maharaj went back to Godhead. His mother went back to Godhead. And in this way, we also are on the way back to Godhead. Just taking initiation is considered a very important thing to do, because it means aligning ourselves. Maybe internally something will remain, maybe internally, but some traces of material anger, some traces of greed, some traces of lust, all that will remain. But still, we align ourselves, and if somehow or other we stick to that alignment, then the process will act, the mercy will act. And of course, there are two factors about attaining success. One factor is sadhana. One factor was Dhruva's endeavor. Few more minutes, and then we finish. did perform salvation. He did make a sacrifice. And he did get a reward for that salvation. So, certainly the salvation was an important factor. But Jehovah also got the mercy of Mary Mooney. Without it, you know, he could have been 100 times in the forest, but it wouldn't have happened. Wouldn't have really done it, you know. Mary Mooney personally came. So, that was really okay. You know, when Narada recognized someone, then the Lord starts to think, okay, yeah, this one, all right, special mercy for this one. Naturally, the mercy starts to flow. Narada opened the floodgates of mercy, and the Supreme Lord showered him with mercy, and the Supreme Lord touched him, and the Supreme Lord transformed him and awoke in him this natural devotional service. He became empowered. When he returned from the forest, he was no longer the one he had been before, and he emanated such saintliness that everyone just was overwhelmed. All this is there. In the end, the Lord fulfilled all his desires. First he was praying. I was approaching the Lord for material desires, only material desires. But he gave me himself. I asked for broken pieces of glass, I got diamonds. But he also fulfilled the other desires, because he did give him a kingdom greater than his father, great-grandfather. And he lived there in great opulence for a very long time, 36,000 years. But eventually, he took his home to the spiritual world, the Vaikuntha, which is the essence. So, we don't have 36,000 years to spend. Right? Even 36 minutes is long. Therefore, we need to do it quickly. We also don't have such a nice kingdom. We have everyone has a little kingdom, but it's not that good. Maybe not that bad either, but that's how you look at it. It's not that bad. Actually, quite good. But it's not that good. It's not as good as Jupiter's. And it doesn't last this long. Therefore, we should now get into this mood of going back to God. And that is really our final prayer here. We pray here that we may get the strength and determination to go back to Godhead this very lifetime. Yeah. And that is why we came here, so that we get a little more resolute. And for a moment we can dream about the spiritual world. And we pray. And then we go there. Nice place to drink. Some people have amazing dreams. Someone wrote to me, they have a Gopal deity. And then the Gopal deity said, this is one of my disciples who is studying medicine in China. So, a little alone there, but she has a Gopal deity. And the Gopal deity said, okay, you go study now, and I go in the forest, and I play with my friends, and then tonight I'll come back, and then you can feed me. That's amazing. Amazing. So sometimes you are in search. Sometimes. So here by the mercy of Dhruva, we pray that we may go back to the spiritual of this lifetime. And all it takes is to just take advantage of this mercy that comes to the parampara. Take initiation and somehow or other live up to it. Yeah. As good as we can. Hold on to it. Don't let it slip away. Because that will be our savior. Thank you. Any questions?
Sorry, can you repeat? What are these two factors after initiation that are very important to achieve the goal?
What did I say? Okay, yes, thank you. There's sadhana and the other one is mercy. So sadhana siddha and kripa siddha. And we're attaining siddha, perfection, through sadhana and through kripa. So in Dhruva Maharaj's situation, there was both sadhana siddha and kripa siddha, combination of two. And without, and of the two, the mercy is the most important. By our own austerity and our own pushing, and I fast every Ekadasi, I stay up all night, I am out there doing all the service, I'm chanting so many rounds, I'm doing all these things because I really want to go back to God. Good. Very good. But now get the blessings of the Vaishnavas. Somehow even please them, because these blessings of the Vaishnavas, they are much greater. So we come also here, there are also Vaishnavas here who are very nice. And they are kindly welcome us in such a place. So when we come here, we should also remember to support their service. Because they serve the Vaishnavas. So gradually, we have to become very soft, very gentle, like chapati dough in the hands of the Vaishnavas. They can put us in any shape they want. And we have to give up our own fixed mind, become flexible according to the desire of the Therefore, scriptures say, seven generations before and seven generations after. If you attain perfection, seven generations before, seven generations after. It's immediate family members, not all the uncles and aunties. And they, but they will get blessed.
Seven generations in future,
Dhruva Maharaj
has already attained perfection in the spiritual world.
I cannot hear.
Dhruva Maharaj, what? When he already attained perfection and he went to the spiritual world, what are his seven generations after
him? I don't know. I mean, I'm not fully aware of the genealogical table. Yeah. But it said he left wife and children. That's why I'm sure it's at least there was one generation. If that generation has the time to make children, I'm not sure. Let's say somebody that maybe may not have children, then we're just good. So there is always seven. That is seven. Not like that. It's personal. Yes, last two, three, four. You don't want to take yourself for sex. No?
Okay. I was thinking that in Dhruva's
I cannot hear you. Tell us something in our voice. Like behind you, there's a translator over there.
In Dhruva's austerity, he pleased Krishna. But what exactly what he did pleased Krishna? Because
he just showed something on the phone and what exactly pleases Krishna?
In Dhruva's austerity, he managed to please Krishna. And I'm wondering what exactly in his austerity would be pleasing to Krishna, because the austerity was very
important. Austere. Important one of his spiritual master. Dhruva got instructions from Narada Muni and he followed those all three. That's why when finally the final moment he was able to chant, because he chanted, he made a deity of clay and he also performed a step. Dhruva had a life after that. Right? It wasn't just like that he stayed like always in the forest like a yogi. No, he also had a life. But he remained fixed at the lotus feet of the world. So he went through different phases in life. A Brahmachari phase, a Grihastha phase, a Vanaprastha phase. But he remained fixed in service to the world. Kept on worshiping.
I was thinking about my question and it's simple.
He's such a big man, he speaks so soft.
What should one do when he doesn't have sufficient intelligence how to please Vaishnava?
What about someone who doesn't have sufficient interest to please
intelligence.
Vaishnava? Intelligence.
Discrimination. What he should do properly in order to please Vaishnava?
You try to be a via media. A via media of the mercy of Parampara. A via media of Krishna. That's how you please the Vaishnavas, by being. So it's not that you have to go around and ask everyone, what would you want? What do you want for your birthday? Not like this. No, you try to be a via media. Like you go and collect some big quantity of Mahaprasadam and you go and give it to all the Vaishnavas. You are studying Srimad Bhagavatam for, you know, in Bhakti Vaibhav for like years, and then you start to teach. Then you pass it on. But I, for example, what I was telling on Dhruva Maharaj, I used to teach it in the Bhakti Vaibhava in Mayapur, this Dhruvavaran pastime, so I didn't then get to that. And after that, I didn't prepare so much because the pace of the Bhakti is, you know, once you're in it, it goes. So I had to do it from memory, but still, because in the past I was able to study how I can talk about it. But it is. You go and get the mercy, you give it to the ashram. That's service to the ashram. Go somewhere and get the mercy. In some form or other, give it to the ashram. That's service to the ashram. Senior Vaishnava, you assist them in whatever they do. Yes.
Hare Krishna, простите, что для вас самое важное в этой истории было?
Sorry, he's laughing. Be quiet. Yeah, I'll never be quiet. It's good. He's really distracted. He can't be there.
Prabhu is asking, what for you personally was the most important thing in this pastime of Guru Maharaj?
Well, that he remained faithful to the order of his spiritual master, that he kept on practicing his sadhana, even although he was going through all the stages of life, from early childhood being like a brahmachari, being like later in Grihastha ashram, later in vanaprastha, but he remained always fixed in his spiritual peace, even when he had moments that passions were returning. Then the elders came, and because he had been practicing faithfully, then he got the mercy, and then the result is at the end he goes back to Godhead. So in this way, I take inspiration from Dhruva, because he had a whole, a complete life, you know? And I also went through a complete life. I'm going through a complete life. So that makes him someone I can take inspiration from. Because I also want to go back to Godhead.
Of mothers and fathers, like,
war, so
I don't know who's my mother.
It wasn't exactly like that. I didn't say I don't know who you are, but he said like, which father with mother?
Yes, that's what.
So he was aware that the dead son who was brought back by Narada was aware that he had had many mothers, many fathers. So he had no attachment at that point. He had remembrance, but no attachment. Now, in this case, it's different because we're dealing with devotees. That son was not a devotee. That son was just going through the cycle of birth and death, life after life. But here we're dealing with those who have done devotional service. So therefore, Dhruva appreciated. So Dhruva was thinking, I have attained all this. And actually, why have I attained this? Because of Suniti. She sent me to the forest. She gave me the instruction that I should approach the Supreme One. Without her, I would have never done that. So it's her credit. And then I go back and I leave her behind. How can I do so? Because of, it said that we are so small as living entities, and sometimes the illusory energy is so all-pervading that even great personalities are sometimes for a moment affected, like Lord Brahma was sometimes for a moment affected. But then you see also that because of their great service, that there are elders who are protecting them.
Krishna will arrange.
Krishna is there. Krishna will send someone. Krishna will send. Krishna will not overlook what we have done. Krishna will send someone. Somewhere. Someone will emerge. And it can be anyone. It can be just some stranger who just suddenly, you know. This is how it is. Nami Bhakti Vanasyati, my devotee will never perish, and Krishna will make arrangements that the devotee will not perish.
Reading about in Shambhavaka, it counts as different layers.
Why don't you speak now?
Yeah, the different layers.
You don't speak any louder.
The human beings, and then the ghosts, the angels, and then the yakshas also mentioned there in some levels in the. Are they like human beings?
They have supernatural powers. They are residing in the Himalayas, and they have supernatural powers. That is what is described. And they are also yakshas in the higher regions of the universe. Kuvera, of course, who is counted as the ancestor, is a brother of Ravana. But mind you, Ravana is the brother who went astray, and Kuvira did not go astray. So, in this way, he has a political background. They are in different regions of the universe. In this pastime, they are being lives. Sometimes Tibetans are also referred to as yakshas.
So they are still there.
Yeah, even today they are yakshas. Okay, last two.
Gets changed and the amount of the austerity. The anger gets pacified, but it is domination does not go against the law. What is it? Is it our determination or our anger?
The determination was engaged in the service of the Lord and our enemy, and the anger had to be overcome. The determination was something, it was a virtue, and he was told to liberate determination, engage in devotional service. His anger, he had to try and control it and leave it now. But Narada could see that it wasn't immediately possible. So Narada was seeing he wants to approach the Supreme Lord, but he is not approaching him with pure desires to just serve him. He is approaching him to fulfill the material desire. But anyway, let him. Let him, because once he will get the darshan of the Lord, he will be purified. So that's what happened. So he approached the Lord with determination. He brought his material condition, his anger with him, and his desires that came from that. But then he, once he saw the Lord, he became purified from him. And the determination was immediately engaged in the service of the Lord. Anger would come out of it. It's very angry. He couldn't just take it away with Krishna. The Lord took that away.
Yes.
She's asking, does it mean that the disciple doesn't have to do anything?
Yes.
And just the teacher could give the...
Yes. It's a nice question. It's an intelligent question. And yes, by mercy, the teacher, the guru, you can take somebody back. And even if they haven't done anything themselves, by mercy, we can be taken back. But we should not count on that. We should not think, okay, then I don't have to do anything. That's why everyone was like that. I cannot just count on all that mercy, I must try and do something. Otherwise, it's just like in Christianity. Jesus has already prayed for us, so we don't have to worry. Everything is okay. Prabhupada has already prayed for us, so everything will be fine. No. We should still try something. Although Prabhupada is praying for us, there's no doubt about it. And we need that prayer also. We still want to do something. Okay. It's 10 o'clock. It's a nice time for a little bit. I think so. We'll go down and eat something. And then we'll continue. Before we go, the Pujari would like to paint. So if you can help a little bit with that, and give something generously.